So welcome, and thank you so much for hanging out with us today over lunch. And we're so excited at the Open African Innovation Research and at the Center for Law, Technology and Society, University of Ottawa. And this is the second of our Open Air Distinguished Speaker Series. And we have the pleasure today of having with us a gentleman that has several hats. He's an academic, trained in Nigeria and Canada, and he holds a Governor General Gold Medal Award for his graduate degree from Dalhousie University. He has taught at the University of British Columbia in the Faculty of Law, and is now a full professor at Osgoode Hall Law School of York University. In addition to that, he is a practitioner, a legal practitioner. He practices law in Canada and in Nigeria, and he's a partner in Blackfriars, a limited liability, a professional corporation and partnership. And in addition to that, he's also, if I may say, a politician from Nigeria, and he is in Canadian equivalent. He's the provincial minister for education in Abia State, which is in the southeastern part of Nigeria, in the Niger Delta axis. So it is my pleasure today to thank you for coming, for members of the diplomatic community that accepted our invitations, for our colleagues, and for the members of the Open African Innovation Research Network, and of course, for our home institution, the Center for Law, Technology, and Society, to welcome Professor Ikechi Mgbeoji to speak to us on the topic you have right there on the screen. Please join me to welcome him.
Thank you, everyone. Let me first warn you that what Chidi said is a gross exaggeration with very minimal contact with the truth. Chidi and I, we've come a long way, and he takes liberties with certain things concerning me. So I'm not surprised that he would just totally, as usual, veer off his own track. Again, let me thank you for coming out this afternoon to listen to what I have to say. Second, let me also thank the coordinators of the Open Air Project for this exceptional opportunity given me to share my thoughts and experiences with you. In particular, I must thank Chidi, Jeremy, Victoria. As you can see, she's still busy at work. Before I proceed to the substance of my talk, I perhaps should warn everybody here that today is not a day for any grand pontification. And for those who came to hear an inspiring lecture or a soaring speech, I'm sorry. None of that is on offer, today. Rather, what I have here is a grinding nuts and bolts discussion. I wouldn't be surprised if by the time I'm done, many people here will be fast asleep. That is to be expected. However, what my talk may lack in oratorical flourishes, it should at least make up for in provoking some degree of thought, some degree of debate regarding the roles, if any, of IPRs when it comes to artisanal and vocational training, particularly for the teeming populations in emerging communities in the third world. Until recently, I was fully and completely an egghead, like Chidi. I teach a course in patent law, amongst other courses. And then I was called upon to serve in the capacity of Secretary for Education. It's been a very steep learning curve for me. I am still learning, but there are a few things which I think I have learned and which perhaps are worth sharing with you today. The governor of the province, it's called the state, when he was inaugurated, promised to offer technical and vocational education training to 100,000 unemployed youths to enable them acquire the necessary skills for wealth creation and for self-independence. It was not the first time a major politician in Nigeria would stand up and make such a very bold declaration. In fact, it's almost common fare in that part of the world. But there was something very different about this particular program. But before I go into that, I'll first ask, why this project? Why offer technical and vocational educational training to unemployed youths? And what, if any, of course, are the roles of IPRs in this project? My talk is divided into three parts. In the first part, I would look into the structure and process of education in Nigeria. In the second part, I will look into the E4E program as it is. And then in the final part, I will try to tease out some of the experiences and lessons we have learned. First, with respect to the structure or function and process of education in Nigeria, perhaps I should start with what was obtainable before what many scholars refer to as the colonial encounter. Prior to the arrival of the British in the 1800s, Nigerian indigenous communities, like most other communities across the world, had a kind of informal, didactic, and experiential way of learning. So if your father was a farmer, you farmed. If your mother was a farmer, you farmed. As she farmed and cultivated the land, you learned from her, you learned from other elders, and so on and so forth. If they were fishermen or fisherwomen, you also learned to fish. If they were ironmongers and blacksmiths, you also learned smithing. So the various human activities were more or less a kind of learning place. You learned by observing, not just those who performed. You also learned from nature. So with a few outliers, it was a thoroughly informal way of learning. Of course, history tells us that to have a cadre of people who sought knowledge for the sake of curiosity, you needed to have some degree of excess capital. It is very difficult for someone who hasn't eaten all morning to begin to speculate as to how many angels can sit on the tip of a needle. It doesn't work. Whether it was in ancient Egypt or Greece or Rome, you needed to have surplus capital. The first scientists, the first philosophers we had were people who were already well fed. They had folks working for them. There was excess capital. So they could afford to go to the square and begin to debate as to the nature of ethics, the nature of morals, the nature of law, and so on and so forth. It was difficult to find any farmer or any blacksmith speculating as to whether there were atoms or no atoms. You needed to first feed yourself before you could engage in such philosophical excesses. And so it was again in traditional Nigerian society. So it was only when some communities began to have some kind of excess capital that they began to have the griots, they began to have people who could philosophize for the sake of philosophy, people who could begin to speculate as to what life is and what life isn't about. So The form and structure of education began to change when capital, of course, began to be accumulated. And it was somehow escalated when Islam was introduced to the northern part of the country through the Sahara Desert. The kings, the rulers, began to send some of their subjects to go learn Islamic law, to go learn. So we could now begin to see that people were becoming a little bit professional in education. They were beginning to acquire knowledge for the sake of acquiring knowledge. Okay? They were moving away from being hidebound in the pursuit of what to eat as the days went by. In the southern part of the country, was very close to the Atlantic Ocean, similar things began to occur. The first encounters began sometime in the late 1300s and started to escalate in the 1400s when the Portuguese and some of the Spanish sailors began to make contact with some of the indigenous communities along the coast, along the Atlantic coast. In fact, some of the very early rulers, called the Olu of Wore, Oba of Benin, and the like, began to send some of their sons and their princes to the royal courts in Europe to acquire learning. As early as, in the 17th century, the Olu of Wore, Olu Atuwasewan, also known as Domingo, had in fact had his one of his sons sent to Coimbra University in Portugal, and the young man took a degree, in 1735 from Portugal. So you could begin to see the emergence of a culture of folks acquiring knowledge, acquiring education, formal education, just for its sake, and moving away from just being busy chasing the food for the day. But the real apogee, was the colonial encounter itself in the 1800s. One could say that that was when the dam really burst. So the British came, but the structure of the colonial enterprise had profound impact on the way and manner in which people acquired formal education. The colonial enterprise was premised on a framework of collecting raw materials from the colonies and shipping them off to the metropolis for further refinement. So if you moved cocoa seeds from Nigeria, you get chocolates in Switzerland and in England. And then the chocolate could be resold, of course, at quite astronomical prices. So there was a huge profit. Palm oil could be moved to England, and then they will come back as soap, as pomade, as cream, and so on and so forth. So what the British did, and this was not dissimilar to what obtained elsewhere in Africa, was that they set up an educational system that was designed to facilitate trade. So they needed interpreters, they needed secretaries, they needed people who could write memos, and so on and so forth. But in terms of technology, in terms of transfer of technical skills, that was never the priority. The real priority was in training clerks, in training secretaries, in having an administrative framework that would facilitate the movement of goods, particularly raw materials, from the colonies to the metropolis for further industrialization. So, local interpreters, translators, clerks, office administrators, etc., were then the folks that called the shots. And the system of education was heavily tilted towards mass producing these kinds of persons. Okay? So there was no real attempt to create a cadre of engineers, a cadre of surveyors, a cadre of people who were trained in the technical and vocational trades. The emphasis was on reading, writing, arithmetic, the three R's. Now, even the intellectual property framework then, which I shall come to later on, was also designed to facilitate, just the rubber stamping of various forms of IPRs. So whether it was patents, there was no real patent office in the colonies. The patent examination was done in London and elsewhere. The local offices were like mere offices to receive the documents. The actual drafting, the actual technical skills were possessed by patent lawyers, by trademark lawyers in London and elsewhere. Okay, so what the local lawyers then were trained to do was just to receive the documents, have them assessed, and then ship them off to England, where those who possessed the requisite technical skills could now go on to look at the technical merits or lack thereof. So we now had a system in which the railways, the seaports, the parks were designed and built by the colonial masters, with the locals only supplying raw labor. So our roads were built by British engineers, and when the British left, the German engineers took over. The bridges, again, were designed and built by British engineers and so on and so forth. So there was a dearth of technically skilled people because the structure of the colonial encounter was such that, a greater emphasis was placed on just producing clerks, people who could read and write. So it led to a regime, more or less, in which white-collar graduates were produced in large numbers, and they commanded enormous respect in various societies there. So sensing this kind of anomaly, there were a few early nationalists, such as Herbert Macaulay, who said, wait a minute, why aren't we producing people who can literally build a country? Without denigrating the importance of clerks and stuff, there are people who say, look, you can't really build a country if you don't have welders, plumbers, electricians, and the like. That there was something really wrong with a system which tended to produce just clerks. Really outraged by this, the late Herbert Macaulay, who was actually a Sierra Leonean returnee and was himself a qualified surveyor in England, championed the setting up of Yaba College of Technology in Lagos. And that was in 1935. So by 1947, Yaba Higher College now metamorphosed into Yaba College of Technology. So that was the first tertiary institution that really paid some serious attention to the training of folks, in technical and vocational skills. If you did a pie chart of all the institutions then, the dominant segment would be left for those who are producing clerks, secretaries, and administrators. Now, so obviously, one could say without any fear of contradiction that Nigeria's educational system was heavily tilted towards production of graduates in the arts and in the liberal studies. But then the retreat of the colonial empire in the 1960s did not yield to any real change in focus and direction. So more than 80% of Nigeria's tertiary education graduates are in the arts and liberal studies. And of course, there is still a huge reliance on technical skills, from overseas. Even as I speak, Nigeria gets most of their subsea welders from Singapore, from Malaysia, from Philippines. Yes, welders from outside the country dominate, particularly in the oil and gas sectors. It is not unusual to find the super rich Nigerians fly in auto repairers even to tomorrow to go fix their Bentleys and their Rolls Royces. So you buy a car, and you can't find someone who can fix your car. It is not unusual to find some super rich Nigerians fly in tilists, just do your tiles. So whilst the middle class will get their tilists from neighboring countries such as Togo or Benin, the real super rich actually go to Germany, they go to Italy to get people to lay their tiles for them in their homes. And this is not ancient history. I'm speaking about what is happening now. So you have a culture in which folks drive expensive cars that no one can fix or repair in Nigeria. You have a culture in which The average Nigerian would tend to look down on any artisan, such as a plumber, a mason, an auto repairer, or a factory worker, or a painter, a woodworker, a welder, or a road construction worker. In fact, it is not unusual for parents to threaten their children that, look, if you don't do well in school, okay, you're going to be a mechanic. Okay, I will send you to go and learn how to fix cars. Okay, so these jobs were more or less reserved for the so-called blockheads, people who couldn't do well in school. So if you were smart in school, your parents, like Chidi's parents, would push him to go study law. You know? And if you didn't do too well in school, they will show you a mechanic and say, you see the mechanic there, you see how dirty his clothes are? That is what you're going to become if you don't do well in school. So you had a culture in which artisanal work, artisans, and the vocational things were more or less denigrated and looked down upon. So everybody rushed to get a white-collar job, to get a degree or a certificate, in business administration, in political science, in law, and the like. So the entire structure of society itself was heavily tilted towards that, with very devastating consequences. Now, consider these facts. Nigerian governments at various levels consume more than 90% of the revenue and income of the state. Yes, we have some of the most bloated civil service anywhere in the world. I, as Secretary for Education, I have about 6 secretaries attached to my office. 3 of them do not have desks, and more than 4 have nothing really to do. I mean, I could do with 1. At Osgood, I share a secretary with about 3 or 4 of my colleagues. And Angela does a pretty good job. So we have a regime in which we have over 100, we have 108 senators. Each of the senators earns more than President Obama. I'm not kidding you. Yes. Each of them collects at least $2 million per annum in security votes and constituency project allowances. That's not it. In addition, there is a lower parliament of more than 300 parliamentarians, each of whom, again, earns more than Obama in salary. Then you have a president, you have a vice president, you have a cabinet of more than 35 ministers, excluding a large coterie of special advisors, special assistants, senior special assistants. I mean, government is so bloated that it is the largest employer of labor in the country. And I argue that it is because of the very skewed nature of the educational system, the system that has paid so much emphasis on white-collar jobs and certification in the arts and liberal studies. So that's not all. You now have 36 states, like 36 provinces, each with a governor, a deputy, and a cabinet of no less than 16 commissioners. I'm not adding, again, the coterie of special assistants, special advisors, senior special this, senior special that. Again, each state would have a House of Assembly. So the cascade goes on and on and on and on. And so the government is so bloated, governance is so expensive, because everybody believes more or less that the only job worth having is a government job. That unless you put on a tie and a suit, and go to the ministry or to one office and sit down, that you don't really have a job. It is not unusual to find someone who is a carpenter or a cabinet maker or a woodworker complain that he or she needs a job. And you say, you have your shop, you have 2 or 3 employees, what else do you want? He said, no, the job that he wants is a government job, because the culture is such that only government jobs are reckoned with as being the real jobs. So again, of course, it's not unusual that in such a scenario, the salaries will be owed sometimes for months. So you have chronic and massive unemployment. We import drinking water, sometimes from France. We import toothpick, sometimes from China. So for nearly 200 years, Nigeria has more or less excelled in producing far more than its unfair share of clerks and secretaries than it does with respect to builders, masons, engineers, plumbers, woodworkers, and other artisans. As I noted earlier on, our best roads were built by the British and then later by the Germans. We drive some of the finest automobiles made in Germany, in France, in America, in Italy, and Great Britain. Virtually every Nigerian youth knows the latest model of any vehicle made in America or made in Germany. We use the latest phones, the most expensive phones. Virtually every Nigerian is crazy about phone. As soon as the latest phone is released, people keep on bugging you. Buy one for me, buy the other one for me. So, of course, we are the second largest consumers of champagne, even though not a single vine grows in Nigeria. Our polytechnics that are meant to produce technicians and artisans award hundreds of thousands of diplomas in mass communication, in business administration, in political science, and the like. So the system is essentially skewed heavily towards consumption rather than production. So we fast forward to 2015. I've just given you the background, the context in which we believe that things can't just continue like this, that something really drastic has to happen. So unemployment of university graduates is far above 50%. Wherever I go most times, before I'm done, I get about 80 to 60 CVs. Oh, secretary, please get me a job. I need a job. These are university graduates. Underemployment is at over 80%. And so, in 2015, the government of Abia State took a hard look at the scenario and said, look, we have to do something differently here. Now, it's not as if he was the man that saw tomorrow. No. Others had attempted trying to relieve this problem. But their methods would appear not to work. There are too many so-called empowerment programs, which is no more than one big politician showing up and distributing maybe 10 caps or 100 motorcycles. Say, yes, I want to empower the youth. I want, I'm giving out 100 motorcycles, maybe from his $1 or $2 million security and constitutional project allowance, buys 100 motorcycles. He says, I'm going to empower you by giving, just sharing out 100 bikes. So you go and use the bikes to run or to operate a transport business. Or some could buy sewing machines and say, I'm giving all the women in this village, 100 sewing machines. So you go and quickly learn how to sew. Whether or not you want to be a tailor, it doesn't really matter. What I have here, I have 100 sewing machines. Just take one, and there you go. So in 2015, I said, the government said no, that this just wasn't going to work, that things really need to change. So to achieve this vision of sustained re-education and reorientation, there was a need to develop a robust system that will ensure sustainability and assure delivery of the program, as well as provide a foundation to attract funding from local and international donor agencies. We just felt that handing out motorcycles, handing out sewing machines, just wasn't the way to go. So as I had argued in the preceding pages, technical and vocational education training in Nigeria had been neglected for a long time. There were both systemic as well as cultural factors that exacerbated that situation, which of course we have dealt with. So under this particular E4E program, the objectives which we set for ourselves include A, to assess the current systems and services in place for technical and vocational education training and youth development, to develop a short, medium, and long-term plan to manage expectations and meet identified needs, to bridge the gap between educational institutions and industry in the state through effective employer engagement strategies and development of fit-for-purpose criteria and their curriculum. Then to re-establish and develop technical and vocational traits in the technical colleges and ensure that they had appropriate accreditation. And then to provide institutional capacity building for technical and vocational education in the state, and to create and manage the various business development centers in the state, and to provide initial and ongoing support for entrepreneurs to ensure successful outcomes. And then, how did we go about it? First, there was already a social climate for it. When you have more than 60% of the youth unemployed, and these are folks who have CVs and their diplomas in their pockets, they are far more likely to listen to you when you say, dude, that piece of paper in your pocket, okay, isn't really gonna take you much further than where you are. Okay, you have to reassess, okay, where you are. Okay, it's not enough to say I have a diploma in English or history or whatever. Okay, yeah, you have a diploma, but it's not gonna put food on the table. It is not going to move this society forward. So, to ensure a buy-in from various stakeholders, particularly those who have suffered from these kind of anomalous situation, we embarked on a massive media campaign that included discussions on radio and television, as well as newspaper coverage. So it was becoming quite obvious that the system just wasn't working. Okay, that it didn't make sense, okay, to spend 4 years in a university only to come out, okay, and be looking for a job for 8-10 years. It just didn't make sense. So we believe that, look, if some of these youths could be retrained, and even if we could stop some people from wasting 4 years in the university, I mean, they could spend a year or 6 months or 18 months in a technical school and learn some kind of trade, some kind of technical school, rather than spend 4 years, you know, studying a subject or a course that they would never, ever utilize or, you know, would not get them any kind of job outside once they graduate. So we also had various stakeholder meetings. We identified the key people and the key groups that are important to the program for its delivery. So in that respect, we got in touch with the Chamber of Commerce. We got in touch with the National Association of Small-Scale Industrialists. We got in touch with the organized private sector, particularly business folks. And these are people who had, you know, seen the light much earlier than others, who realized that, look, I was better off creating a business. I was better off doing something on my own rather than pounding the streets with my CV and with my diploma in my pocket, looking for a job that simply doesn't exist. So we also got in touch with stakeholders in agriculture. And for it to be part of the education system, we also talked to the various heads of schools, the tertiary institutions, because to us, these were the folks who were contributing to a very, very anomalous regime. You know, they kept on promising students of a great, grand future, okay, when in fact it was obvious to them that that wasn't going to happen. I recall about 2 or 3 years ago when some people in the U.S. filed lawsuits against some law schools, okay, for promising them heaven on earth when they graduate, only to realize that as soon as they left the law schools with their fancy degrees, that they weren't going to get the $100,000 startup jobs. Okay, I'm not trying to say that law school is such a bad idea, but but the point I'm making is that is that what those folks in the U.S. we are suggesting or we are hinting at, okay, isn't very dissimilar from what we are pushing down there. We felt that, look, it was time to tell ourselves the brutal, honest to God truth. So we got in touch with the various provosts and rectors of the tertiary institutions in the state, for them to have a very hard look at their curricula. It just didn't make sense, you know, to be offering courses that would just lead to nowhere. And people would pay through their noses. They'll spend 3, 4, 5 years in the schools, and then when they graduate, there was nothing to do with their diplomas. So to that end, we had to basically rejig the curricula of the various tertiary institutions, particularly those that were originally founded to produce and to train folks in the technical and vocational arts. So we also set up a website. We went on Facebook and the like, and we began to engage. And then, of course, we launched the program. Now, with respect to the institutional support, there were quite a lot of moribund technical schools that we had to spend some really good money to refurbish. There was one particular school that had 40 toilets, and those 40 toilets had just, boom, gone down. It wasn't being used. So I went in there. I had those 40 toilets fixed. I went to Germany. I spoke to some German government agencies. And they were so gracious. They donated a huge set of machines, you know, block molding machine, desk making machines, all kinds, different kinds of machines. Those machines are now being used in those schools. So the point was that these donors gave us tools that we could use to train some of these people. And in fact, there was one particular case where the factory in Germany agreed to let the students in Nigeria basically watch what was going on the factory floor through the internet. So they would put a camera there, and then the folks there could be watching them actually produce things. And it was quite cool. So we began to again look into commercial farms because we know that there's a lot of opportunity with respect to agriculture. But more importantly, we began to develop for the first time what is known as the labor market information system. We want to know. We want to make decisions based on data. We just didn't want to act on mere hunch. So the labor market information system, known as LMIS, gave us information with respect to economic and labor market conditions, education, qualifications, training and skills, and current and future demand and supply of labor and jobs. So we did this by getting in touch with factories, getting in touch with business people. You know, we gave out questionnaires and dossiers, and then they filled and got back to us. And we now did a collection of data from the unemployed youth. You know, we sent out forms to them, which they filled, and then we had to crunch those numbers. So we looked into issues such as their age, their gender, their qualifications, their interests, and the like. So in all, we profiled in the first quarter 35,000 unemployed youths. So after the profiling, what we now did was to create an ID, a chip-enabled ID, for each and every one of them. And they will receive stipends, monthly stipends, while they are receiving these retraining programs. And also, we did collect data on the organized private sector in the state. I mean, since the major delivery mode of the E4E is modern apprenticeship, you cannot do it without the organized private sector. So we went into the factories. We needed to know from them, okay, what kind of products do you make? Do you have any room to take on interns? Don't pay the interns. We shall pay the interns. All you have to do for us is to train them. Let them go in there, know how things work. Then we also collected data on the trainers and those who would provide training. So in sum, based upon the data which we have gathered, the next phase was with respect to quality assurance. So to ensure quality assurance, we had to separate it into two categories, the internal quality assurance and the external quality assurance. With respect to the external quality assurance, that is where the Ministry of Education, the Ministry of Labor, and the National Board of Technical Education, you know, would come in. And then with respect to external quality assurance, we got in touch with the Pearson Group, which is based in the US, got in touch with Citi and GIT. So the point here is that we just didn't want to go through the well-trodden route of, you know, calling folks and distributing motorcycles or sewing machines to them. We went you know, through the heavy lifting grant approach. Now, with respect to funding, we've been quite fortunate. We received enormous support from the World Bank, from the World Bank Youth Employment and Social Support Operation, and the federal government and other donors. Now, the essence of this is that after the training, then we'll get into funding. Because once a person has been trained, he or she will need some kind of startup capital. You know. But the problem in the past was that people were just giving money. They didn't have the requisite skill. They didn't even know what to do with the money. Some would say, give me the money first, okay, I will then figure out what to do with the money. And of course, as soon as they get the money, they go to the nearest pub, you know, have a very cold beer, or you know, maybe go watch a football match or something. So it just wasn't working. And that was why we had to, like, you know, break the mold and rethink the entire structure and process. So I now come into the third and final part of my talk, and I must commend you for your patience. So what roles, if any, does IPRs, okay, have to do or play in this regard? Surprisingly, we had thought that there was going to be problems if we sent lots of youths into factories, into workshops, you know, owned and operated by private individuals. But they would be quite cagey about disclosure of certain information, particularly, you know, business secrets and the like. So it was quite a kind of rude shock to someone like me to realize that, first, that there wasn't even much concern from the organized private sector and the business people, you know, about, you know, theft or loss of IPRs such as patents, you know, or infringement of copyrights. They were quite welcoming. In fact, many of them were of the view that, wow, we didn't even know that we could have thoughtful people in government. We always thought that, you know, we had jokers and clowns in government. That this is the first time they were actually seeing people, okay, people who are in government, come to them to say, what is it that, you know, you can help us do, particularly with respect to training and retraining of unemployed people. But before I go into the details, let me perhaps give some broad strokes about the structure and process of IPRF regime in that country. Like the education system, which I have dealt with at length, the IPR system, okay, was also a colonial import. Prior to the arrival of the British, there were no trademark offices, there were no patent offices, and so on. It's even interesting that before there was a Nigeria, there was, in fact, a trademark office in Nigeria, in the sense that the British were so concerned about trade that before the amalgamation of North and South Nigeria to produce or to yield Nigeria in 1914, there was, as early as 1898, a trademarks office. You know, it's quite very, very, very telling that the importance of trademarks, okay, as a major form of IPR was well known and well appreciated by the British even before the creation of Nigeria itself. And so the IPR's offices were set up, and as I had adumbrated earlier on, it wasn't really designed to facilitate or to encourage the development of technical skills in the country. It was, like other things, designed to facilitate trade and to promote the colonial enterprise. okay, perhaps at the expense of local businesses. But then the other thing which is quite profound here was that the early IPRs practitioners, as I argued elsewhere, were mentally and culturally on the same page with the British. They didn't find anything wrong with some of the excesses of the IPR system. And even to date, myself and Chidi and people who sometimes kick against the hard edges of the IPR regime are in the minority. This is what I call the comprador complex. You know, you have a system in place which someone from a very wealthy background goes to Cambridge or Oxford. He comes back to Kenya or Nigeria or any of these former colonies. He or she practices IP. The IP practice is very lucrative. But unlike the IP practitioner in Ottawa or in Washington, who is required and expected to possess certain technical skills, his or her colleague in the former colonies has no such expectations at all. Okay? So you find a patent lawyer here, he or she will draft patent claims. Okay? Many patent lawyers will tend to have some prior qualification in the engineering and other fields before getting to law school. So you know, they quickly understand some of the technical jargon and so on and so forth. There's not one patent lawyer I know of in Nigeria who can draft a patent claim. Why? Because the system does not require that he or she should possess such technical skills. So the claims and everything are drafted here. Okay, so if it is a PCT application, okay, once it has gone to the stage of entry into the national phase, it gets shipped off to Nigeria. Then the lawyer in Lagos, okay, takes it to the local patent office. There is no examination, okay, there is no requirement on his part to even understand what the invention is about. So as long as the documents meet formal compliance standards, that's it. So, okay, it is stamped, it is sealed, voila, you have your patent certificate issued. And then he sends his fee note, maybe $5,000 or $2,000, and he gets paid. So in essence, quite frankly, he or she is a glorified clerk. Okay, there is very little intellectual input required and or expected of him. Not that the person is a dunce. Far from that. These are well-trained lawyers. But the system, okay, established by the British, because there was no requirement for local examination under the laws that the British set up or established in the colonies. So the local IP offices were essentially receptacles. Their task and function was to receive those documents, okay, make sure that there was the formal compliance, and then that's it. So because the system did not require that anyone should train oneself in the technical aspects of IP work, it affected and still affects the practice. It affects the jurisprudence. It is difficult to find any judgment by the courts that deal with some of the hardcore issues of law. Okay? In many cases, important disputes tend to be dismissed and or resolved on technical grounds. Maybe the document wasn't properly filed, it wasn't properly stamped, it was argued out of time and so on and so forth. There are very few rigorous decisions on the real substantive points. That's the point which I seek to drive home here. So it is not surprising in that regard to find that there is very little opposition, particularly from the informal and organized private sector, with respect to these interns, okay, coming into close touch or into close contact with some IPRs protected properties. It's only with respect to those corporations that have parents here in the West that we've received some degree of scrutiny. So you send the interns to the local corporation. There's very little question in terms of, oh, what will happen to copyrights, okay? In case something is made in the cause of internship, who gets to own it? How do we share it, and the like? There is very minimal question that so far that we've received with respect to that. The questions that we have so far tended to receive come from the multinationals. So you have the bigger drug companies who will now want to know, okay, why should we take in these interns? Okay, if in the course of their internship, you know, there is an infringement of our IPRs, what do we do? But many of these questions actually come by way of forms, template forms that are already in existence. The usual forms that they would hand out to prospective employees. Okay, so it's a boilerplate form. Okay, you are not supposed to divulge secrets and so on and so forth. So in a nutshell, it may be a kind of underwhelming response, because I was thinking, you know, the time we were designing this project, that IPRs, you know, was going to be a very serious and contentious issue. You know, I mean, and then contrary to what one gets from the usual scholarship, you know, a lot of people tend to blame corporations for being so miserly or being so aggressive when it comes to defending their territories with respect to IPRs. But our own experience so far, you know, is that there's been quite little in terms of a pushback, and that we've actually experienced, you know, to a very large degree, a kind of welcoming and open arms, and that IPRs really do not constitute an impediment to the successful training of interns. Now, perhaps that may be attributed to the kind of low awareness of IPRs in the system, okay, or to the perception that there won't be much harm arising from the interaction or the kind of contact that one would expect that will arise, you know, when interns or other workers get into close touch with IPRs in the private state. So to sum it up, our position and my argument is that for those who believe that IPRs, you know, unless radically restructured, would continue to pose a kind of drag on foreign investment, or would pose a kind of hindrance to the training of interns, it will appear that those arguments are not well founded. The better view seems to be that people can and should be retrained without significant concerns being expressed as regards whether or not the trainings are IPRs compliant. I thank you very much for listening. I would rather take more questions and comments at this stage. Again, let me, before I take my seat, thank Jeremy, Chidi, and Victoria for thinking of bringing me over here to Ottawa. And I thank each and every one of you for making our time to come listen to me. I'm surprised no one has dozed off. I take it that maybe it's still afternoon, and not because that I said anything that is remotely interesting. Thank you very much. Yes.
We have a roaming microphone.
Okay. Okay, I think I'm loud enough. Thank you. Thank you for this interesting presentation. It's not every time that we got to speak. We got a speaker who is a professor a practitioner, a politician. This is my question, because I come from the same background as you, both in training and in career path. As I was listening to you, something occurred to me. You are the provincial minister for education, the way we understand it here in Canada. And I was wondering, given the bloated nature of the bureaucracy in Nigeria, how have you been able to carefully delineate your boundary of authority and power? For example, I know that it's not impossible to have a Ministry of Labor, Ministry of Youth, Ministry of Employment within the same cabinet. And so how have you been able to navigate this? Because as far as the last time I checked, you were still the Commissioner for Education. But most of this activity appear to be happening in the realm of employment, youth, and the labor. How have you managed that in your cabinet?
Well, thank you very much. As you well know, in private discussions, you know, I had hoped that by now that I would have slain some dragons. I had gone in with the high hopes of effecting change and making some profound difference, which is, it hasn't been easy. But what I have learned so far is that in many of the cases, if you explain things to people and get their buy-in, you know, and they trust that you are not out to take their job or to take the spotlight away from them, you know, that you are quite willing to use that phrase, to lead from the back, okay? I don't mind doing all the grunt work, okay? Just let me have your buy-in. So, and if you want to be the one to announce it, if you want to be the one to take the glory, I am very comfortable with that. So it's been a very steep learning curve. But I found that, you know, having a very honest and transparent approach really helps. A lot of times people tend to be very territorial if they don't understand where you're coming from, or if you've not bothered to explain the thing to them, and if you're not willing to even let them just take the glory insofar as the job gets done. I maybe it's something I learned when I was a very young person. You know, let me tell you this story. Maybe it's off the record. When I was in primary school, I think I was like 10 or 9, I had a habit of each time the teacher asked a question, my hand would be the first up in the air, you know, and they say, yes, yes, yes. And I'll answer the question, and everyone will clap for me. But then, you know, I got into trouble. It got to a point where during break time, my friends would say, okay, you answer all the questions in the class, you go play with the teacher. You won't play with us. So I learned then that, okay, so if answering the question was going to get me into trouble with my friends, that I'd rather not answer any question anymore in the class, okay? So I'd rather play with my friends, okay? I could still sit for the exams and pass. I didn't need to provoke them or to get them to resent me. So in a cabinet, I've learned that sometimes, you just need to, you know, if people think that you think you're smart or that you act to be smart, you could actually not achieve anything. So let them take the glory. I don't mind getting the job done. So that was how I learned to survive primary school. That's how I'm learning to survive here. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you very much, sir. I must really say it's really very interesting, and it has helped to throw more light and information. I'm a Nigerian myself, but I must confess that I didn't know much of this history in terms of intellectual property in Nigeria till now, and I'm really grateful for this lecture. But I have two questions for you, sir. First of all, you talked about the role of IPROs. Yeah, and they are not being concerned about you know, their trademark and, you know, all that. I feel personally that it's because of lack of orientation and awareness. And the world we know now is a global village. And very soon, I think that will be a problem that everyone will have to be faced with, because I have a background in law too. I know friends and family sometimes will want to come, or even on the road, people might want to stop you for legal advice. And I have always tactically said, oh, why not see me in the office, or you know that, because to them, they doesn't know that it's an intellectual right. You have an intellectual right to that. It's your intellectual property and you have to safeguard it. So what effort and structure has been put in place in terms of policy and regulation to address this issue if it arises in the future?
Thank you very much. Thank you. I think that there is a growing awareness of the importance of intellectual property rights. Recall, I think about 2 weeks ago, someone had the presence of mind to go back to President Obama's speech when he won the election, and then just oppose him with President Buhari's speech, and there was an eerie similarity to both speeches. And then there was this whole storm on plagiarism. People said, wow, the president, you've plagiarized Obama's speech. I was very happy, okay? For the first time, we actually had a situation in which a president was being accused of plagiarizing someone else's speech. And the uproar was very, very illuminating, because for the first time, actually, government sat up and said, wait a minute, this is true. Because if you listen to both speeches, it was almost verbatim, without any credit being given to Obama. And as most of us know, there was an inquiry made, and they said that someone had been punished, the speechwriter. Well, I don't know the point, but it is telling that at least the issue arose. So I think in this social media age, and with people not having a very short memory, it's becoming quite common to hear people speak the language of IPR. So it is something that is going to crop up. How we cope with it, let me give you two possible answers to that. One is they may have a boilerplate response. As in my lecture here, I did mention that the big multinationals send boilerplate agreements. So this intern, you just sign here and put your name here and date. And these are forms that are usually drafted by the in-house IP lawyers, maybe vetted by the external counsel. But that shows some degree of awareness on the part of that particular sector. That awareness hasn't really been reciprocated on the side of the informal sector, where they are not yet on the same page with the multinationals and big business. The big business have their own response, which is the boilerplate agreement. The roadside artisan or technical worker or factory owner, hasn't really gotten to the stage where he or she is really worried about the theft or misappropriation of IP. Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Thanks for taking the time to come in today. I had a question about the companies themselves. Are they being appointed by the government in a way like contributing to that bloating you were talking about, or can they apply in a way to participate in these sponsorships?
Well, they're not contributing to bloating, because these are private businesses, so they don't hire unless they need to hire. But they are helping us with respect to training and retraining of some of these on unemployed graduates.
Do they apply to the government, or does the government?
We have done the profiling of all these unemployed youth. So we have about 35,000 now. So we have five major areas where we are looking into, farming, woodworking, shoe, and so on and so forth. So once we get the forms and we've done the profiling, will now get in touch with the relevant industry and say, look, we have so and so persons, okay? Can you please help us take them on board? You know, don't pay them, we pay them. You know, you just let them know what you're doing, you train them, and then once you are satisfied that they have learned some of the things, we will now get into the next stage of trying to help them stand on their own feet by giving them the money required to set up a small-scale version. Yeah. Okay, yes.
If there's nobody else, then I can ask.
Yeah.
So what I'm thinking about is, what you have done is almost like a politician knowing that your tenure is just 4 years, right? And something has to be done. And it's really very effective. But I'm thinking, have you taken a look at the whole Abia State educational profile? I know that your home state has a number of universities, one or two or more, I'm not sure, but they also have some schools within your ministry. In terms of something enduring, after you leave office, how have you envisioned a certain degree of stability or continuity with this program? Because somebody comes tomorrow and says something else, and then the storyline changes, as the experience is always the case. So have you thought about something more enduring?
Yeah, thank you. I think there are two aspects or segments to in response to your question. First, we've tried to institutionalize this program so that it is not about me, it's not about someone else, it's just about a proper institution. Second is that we are actually trying to turn off the tap that produces this huge number of unemployed, unemployable graduates. And that's with respect to the curriculum. You know, we've had a regime, a system in place in which even polytechnics graduate people in political science. Polytechnics. So, and thank goodness that the people themselves are beginning to realize that these courses, you can't just go to a school for 4 years, pay so much money just because you want to come out with a diploma. When you graduate, okay, you really need to find yourself somewhere. So there has been a kind of change, a kind of shift in society. People are beginning to realize that, well, okay, I know someone who has a fish farm, okay, who is doing pretty well. I know someone who runs a restaurant who is doing pretty well. I mean, when you open a restaurant, you employ 5, 6, 10, 20 people, okay? So they are seeing people who do these jobs that hitherto they used to look down on. But they're seeing them now paying their bills, employ people, and they are upstanding members of society. So in that respect, we've been helped by this change, this shift in a social attitude. If you remember, 30 years ago, if you were a comedian in Nigeria, you die of hunger. But today, stand-up comedians are millionaires. You know, if you played football 40 years ago, you get your bones broken and you die in poverty. But today, those who do well so the point is that they are actually seeing people whose lives, okay, are a lot better because they didn't necessarily beat the well-trodden path. But then the more substantive intervention is with respect to the curriculum of the schools in question. You know, you have a regime system in place in which technical schools aren't really doing the technical stuff. You know, they are trying to do things which they are not well equipped for. So it requires changing their curriculum. It requires giving them the necessary tools with which to train people. Unfortunately, at this point, there's very little money. So we've been relying more on donor agencies. We're not saying give us money. We're saying buy the tools for us, buy the training materials, ship them to us. And so far, we received over €1 million worth of tools and equipment. We received the tools and equipment in shoemaking. We received the shoe and equipment in photography. No, people don't even realize that you could be a very good photographer and apply all kinds of technical skills in photography. and you know, get people employed. So we are getting the equipment, but more importantly, we are trying to make it an institutionalized thing. It is not a one-off event.
My question, and I'm asking it for the broader audience because it is a question that we have here. The program is specifically education for employment. But as you just mentioned, we don't know what necessarily the jobs of the future will be, right? I mean, a comedian would have been broke before, but now they can make money. Here, there are people who make money purely off of social media, which didn't even exist before, right? How do you know, or how do you try to make it broad enough to appeal to jobs that we don't even know that they're going to exist? Having people prepared for mystery jobs.
Thank you, Victoria. Maybe we're not as foresighted as we should be. We've been more or less focused on the jobs of today. The idea is that some of these jobs, some of these products will always be with us. The social media practitioner will still need a chair, a table, and a desk. You know, he would eat. You know, he will need to wear clothes. You know, we are yet to see IT person, you know, live on air alone. So we are trying to deal with those almost eternal needs. You know, those jobs that we know are enduring, without trying to somehow blank out the possibilities of tomorrow.
Thank you. Victoria has a gift for you, but before she does that, or as she's doing that, I'd like to just acknowledge our funders, the Open Air Research Network's funders. That's the Social Sciences Humanities Research Council, the International Development Research Center, the UK Department of Foreign International Development, as well as the University of Ottawa Center for Law, Technology and Society. We're very grateful for the funding that's able to put this event on, and for you for sharing your time with us. And I'll turn it over to Victoria.
Thank you.